And the one spirit is talking about the Holy Spirit. How many, I don't know, okay, let me ask this. Any of your parents or aunts or uncles, have you ever, maybe they took you to like a prayer service or something, and then they're praying for people, then they fall, and then they speak weird languages. Anybody? No? Yes? Okay. So that's kind of what I'm going to explain about today. Okay? The Holy Spirit has to manifest through us. Manifest means to like show himself through us. Okay? And this is what the scripture is talking about. The different gifts that the Holy Spirit uses us with, equips us with, to go out there and do the things that the apostles did. God doesn't just give us, okay, I put you here on this earth, I want you to do my will, and that's it. He doesn't just tell us, he doesn't just put us in front of, you know, this whole world and not give us tools, right? In school, the teacher doesn't say, okay, do this test. Not teaching you anything, right? Sometimes, that's not good. But we are going through this journey, right? We have to learn. We have to study, like in school, in order for us to reach graduation, okay? So just like walking our life with Christ, the Holy Spirit speaks through us, and he gives us these gifts. And like what I said, supernatural versus natural, okay? These are all the supernatural gifts. The things that's beyond our understanding, the things that are beyond what we can see, the things that will kind of blow us away, that's within us that we're doing or we will start doing. So what charismatic gifts are gifts of the Holy Spirit. These are gifts given to a person to benefit another, like what that 1 Corinthians says, right? A person, if they are open and willing, will be used by the Holy Spirit according to the discretion of the Holy Spirit. If they are open and willing. So like I said, if your faith goes deeper and deeper in God, your spiritual life is more rooted in Christ, and you're more open, God will reveal all, the Holy Spirit will reveal these gifts to you. I'm just going to go through some of them. And I'm gonna go into a couple of them more in depth. But there's like nine different gifts, and each of them are called certain gifts. Like these are revelation gifts, spiritual gifts that reveal something. Wisdom, okay, everyone knows what wisdom is, right? And wisdom is something that we can always use every day from the Lord, right? To make the right judgment on things. To go the right way, which school, which college, which career, things like that. Word of knowledge. This is a message that someone gives. They like, say like someone's praying for you. They don't know you, they're a stranger, okay? All of a sudden they're like, they say something like, Jesus wants to heal you from all the pain and the brokenness you're going through, okay? That's word of knowledge. That comes from the Lord. That comes from the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit speaks to the person that is praying for you. Has that ever happened to anybody? Like all of a sudden someone prays for you and then you don't know this person, but all of a sudden they know something about your past or about your life. That is a word of knowledge that they receive for you. And then there's discernment. Discern means to perceive by hearing or seeing. It reveals what kind of spirits is in operation behind a manifestation, whether evil, human, or Holy Spirit. Discernment. Discernment is something that we need in our life every day, okay? Discernment meaning, God, is it right for me to be hanging out with these people? Is it right for me to be hanging out with these friends? Okay, things like that. And power gifts of the Holy Spirit, spiritual gifts that do something. Gift of faith, uncommon faith, a total surrender of one's own will and selfish desires. Gift of miracles or mighty deeds. Maybe someone's praying for somebody, all of a sudden they're healed of cancer. miracle. And gift of healing, supernatural healing of sickness or disease without any natural source of means. And then the last is the oral gifts, spiritual gifts that say something. Gifts of prophecy to build up, and it has to line up with the word of God. It can bring correction, but not to make people feel condemned. So maybe we're in a Bible study or a prayer group, and then all of a sudden someone says, the Lord says, do not fear. Do not be afraid. And it lines up with the scripture. That's a prophecy. Okay, we're like in the midst of a group, and then we're praying, all of a sudden someone says something. And then there's gifts of the varieties of tongue, which I'm going to go more in depth with about. And there's interpretation of tongues. It is to interpret the gifts of tongues so it may edify or comfort the church. Let's go back to the gifts of tongues. Has anybody ever heard someone speak the gifts of tongues? No? Yes? Okay. What did you think about it? Like, were you all... Did you know what it was? You're rooted out. Okay. You thought it was another language? Okay. In Corinthians earlier, if you see about Pentecost, right, the disciples started speaking in different languages, but somehow they like understood each other. So with prayers, sometimes, like the scripture says, 1 Corinthians 14:14, for if I pray in a tongue, my spirit prays, but my mind is unfruitful. Right? Have you guys ever had those instances where you're praying, but your mind is kind of scattered, thinking about other things, like what do I have to do later? But the spirit in you is praying to God, okay? And it says, so what shall I do? I will pray with my spirit, but I will also pray with my understanding. I will sing with my spirit, but I will also sing with my understanding. Okay. Romans 8:26-27 says, in the same way the spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the spirit himself intercedes for us through wordless groans. Okay, that is the scripture about the gift of tongues. If you receive the gift of tongues, your prayer life just changes. When I first received it, it was at a conference called SCRC. It's every Labor Day weekend. And what happened was I was just sitting there and I was praying, and then you can tell the difference, like all of a sudden, these weird sounding syllables just come out. I've heard it before with my parents, and yeah, I freaked out. So who said they freaked out? I was like, what are they praying? And I thought they were like, you know, going, it was weird, okay? So it's just like these different syllables, and then that is your spirit. And what Roman said, your spirit is praying with these groans. Like, we don't understand it, but it's your spirit interceding and praying to God. Like I said, when you receive it, your prayer life just changes. Does anyone here have the gift of tongues? Any of the... Because I know you guys, some of you, that's from here, went to Steubenville, right? Did any of you receive anything? No? Okay, so when you're praying in tongues, your prayer life just changes. It's like your prayers are answered faster, it seems like. And it's so different. It's hard to explain. But like what it says in the scriptures, right? It's your spirit interceding with God. So no one else understands that. And the gift of tongues is something that it's the first like charismatic gift that most people receive, but sometimes you receive other things. So why am I sharing all these things with you guys, right? Your question is kind of like, okay, I'm not ready for this, maybe, some of you. The Lord has called us here. This is called a Holy Spirit retreat, a life in the seminar retreat, right? Life in the Spirit seminar. So after we receive, like I said, confirmation, God wants us to be out there as apostles of the church, okay? He wants us to be doing his works. And like I said, when your faith is more rooted in your spirituality and your openness, your willingness and your openness to God, he will allow the Holy Spirit to give you these gifts. And sometimes, like, all of a sudden, it'll just blow your mind, like, you will be praying for someone, or you will be comforting a friend, and all of a sudden they feel so much joy, or you'll be praying for someone that's sick and all of a sudden they get healed, or you will be praying somewhere in a community and you pray and pray and then all of a sudden you receive the gift of tongues. Things like that. Those are the gifts that the Holy Spirit equips us to be his apostles. I know maybe right now all this information seems overwhelming and everything, and you're just, you know, like, just blown out of the water, but just be open to Christ. Just be open and just allow him on things like this retreat. What else do you guys have here? Bible study nights, things like that, or even with yourself in your room, you know, turn on a Christian, like a godly music. Sit there and pray, read the Bible, and God will just start revealing things to you. The Holy Spirit will start working in you in the ways that you won't even imagine that you'll go through. So I encourage all of you guys to just open your heart to Christ, to the Holy Spirit, to allow him to lead you more in depth with him. Amen? So right now, I'm gonna introduce Celine, and she has a sharing about the Holy Spirit and how he's used her.
Hi. How's everyone today? My name's Celine, if you didn't know that. I'm 19. I currently go to UCI. I was born in Orange to a Vietnamese, well, obviously a Vietnamese family, but I was actually fortunate enough to have grown in the Catholic Church, and my parents have taught me to always pray and to always rely on the Lord. And they always taught me the value of what is good, what is bad. So growing up, I had always thought that, you know, if I did something bad, God would hate me and that I would, you know, I'm a bad person, I'm gonna go down there. That's what I was told. And my parents also, like, the Vietnamese culture is very strict and very rigid. It's very like, you know, you do this or, you know, dishonor on your family. But I was put into Catholic school, so all my life I had felt that God was this person that would judge me, I guess. And it wasn't until actually my confirmation winter retreat with Amanda Turcotte over there, similar to something like this, I had encountered the Lord. When I was praying about this testimony, they had asked me to give one about the gift of tongues, and I had given one before, and I was thinking, okay, God, I'll just, you know, give the same one. And I prayed about it, and I felt him, you know, thinking like, no, that's not what I want you to do. And I was like, okay, then I'll give something else when I first encountered you. And still he was like, no, that's not it. And then I started journaling late into like 3 a.m., and I came across this one rough patch in my life that I felt God was saying, you're ready to tell this story. And I had told him, I was like, no, no, I'm not. And he said, yeah, you are. You know, like, it's very clear. It's clear as day. So I'm going to take you guys back to my freshman year. I had met a friend, and God had blessed me with him. He was my best friend someone that I studied with, someone that who understood what I was going through at home with high expectations of straight A's, someone that listened to me when I felt like I wasn't close to God, and he's not even Christian. He totally felt like he wouldn't really understand what I was saying, but he always reminded me to go back to God, even though he didn't know God. And he was someone that I had shared my dreams with of college. You know, I would tell him about it, all my fears, anything family related. He was the person that I would go to. And closer to senior year, we got really close, and I just felt like I needed to pray about it. And for this entire friendship, I prayed to God that he would be closer to Jesus. I was just like, I just really want you to know him, and I want him to know you. So when my senior year started, I had this prayer that I would give every single day, and I said, Lord, if it is in your will for us to be together, I ask that you help me give me the strength to lead him to you. And I said, if it's not in your will, I ask that you give me the courage to not fall into that temptation if it's not what you want. Over the course of the year, we got closer, and we dated for 9 months, and I was so thankful and so happy. There was nothing wrong with our relationship. We were still best friends. I felt like I still had him. I didn't feel like there was any change. He encouraged me to go to church when I didn't know what college to go to, when my grandmother was in the hospital. And I kept praying. I said, Lord, thank you so much for such a gift, you know, someone, thank you for him, you know, like he makes me closer to you, and I ask that that doesn't go away, and I also ask that you have me keep you in my vision, because I don't want to turn away from that. When the summer came, we had both decided to go to UCI, and we were hanging out 2 days before move-in day, and I felt like there was something going on in his mind, and I had finally had the courage to ask him. And I said, what's going on, you know, like, what are you feeling? And he said, I don't think we can do this anymore. And I just nodded, and I said, okay. I said, what's going on, you know? And he's like, it's not you, I promise. And I was like, oh no, cliche line. and I said, okay, then what is it? And he said, you're not Hindu. And he said, my parents don't want me to be with anyone that isn't of my faith. They don't want me to be influenced by you. And he said, like, I don't know what to do. He said, I still care about you a lot. You're still my best friend. He said, you're the nicest person I know. I don't know what to do. Tell me what to do. And I couldn't say anything. I was quiet for a little bit, and he was like, okay, what are you thinking? And I said, well, the last thing I would want is for you to be away from your family. The last thing I want you to do is to convert or something. Like, of course I want him to be with Jesus, but I don't want him to do it for me. I want him to do it for God. I want him to do it because, you know, Jesus loves him. I want him to know that. And so we both talked about it, and we're like, okay, I think we should, you know, break up, you know? And he said, yeah. And I said, okay, like, are your parents okay with us being friends? And he was like, they actually told me that they don't want me to ever talk to you again. They don't want me to text you, to, you know, have classes with you, you know? And I was like, okay, you know, that's fine. That night, I went home.